All right, folks, welcome back. This is RenmanMusicAndBusiness.com. My name's Steve Rennie, and I am the Renman. And I want to welcome you back to Renman U. This is session number 5 now. We're going to be talking about organizing your business, talking legal contracts and the like. Today, we're going to be talking about 4 of the most important agreements you'll likely sign as an artist. We're going to talk about band member agreements. We're going to talk about that much talked about management agreement. We're going to talk about record deals and publishing deals today. It's important stuff, folks. So I've invited today an expert to join us today that knows all the details, the ins and outs. We're going to be joined today by top music business attorney, Mr. Gary Gilbert. He's one of the smartest guys in the music business. He's going to help us understand all the key points you need to know to have a career in this business. But before we get started, I want to give you a little idea of what we're doing here at Renman U. If this is your first time, I'm going to tell you what it's all about. It's not like most places you're going to go to learn the music business, that's for sure. Nobody's ever accused me of looking like a professor, and that's okay. Renman U is my little insider's guide to today's music business. It's my attempt to teach all of you everything you need to know about at the big picture level of how to succeed in today's music business. Now, I'll tell you that we're not talking theory here at Renman U. This is kind of the reality TV version of the music business. No bullshit, the way it really is. And I'm going to share with all the folks here in the studio and all the folks online today all the lessons I've learned from 36 years as a concert promoter, a record label exec, an internet entrepreneur, and an artist manager. Now, as you've probably noticed, there's no campus here at Renman U. No ivy covered walls, nothing that like that at all. We exist only on the web. So our classroom is open to anybody on the planet that wants to learn about the music business. Doesn't matter where you live. If you've got a connection and a computer you're in, there's always seats available here at Renman U. Another important note is for the record, if you haven't figured out, we're not handing out any diplomas here at Renman U. So if you're one of those folks that are looking for a piece of paper that you think will get you a job in the music business, then you're probably in the wrong place. What we are handing out is real bona fide experience about the music business. And for those of you that are serious about making music a career and understand that connecting with real professionals is the best way to learn, then you're in the right place today. One final point, and an important one for lots of folks around this world. There's no tuition. This is free, okay? You don't need a rich dad to pay the bill today. No student loans are required. If you really want to learn about the music business, this one's on me. Okay, so that's what I'm going to do for you folks out there. Here's what I want from you guys. I want you to be a part of it, okay? I want to know that you have a burning desire to do something big in the music business. If you have a burning desire, then you're going to show up. It's a key item. It seems simple, but I want you to show up. I want people to demonstrate their commitment to doing something big in the music business, because that commitment is everything. The best way to do it is to ask questions. Now, if you watched our show before, you've heard it before, I'll say it again. We got a saying around here at RenmanMB: if you don't ask, you don't get, and you don't learn a darn thing here. We blew the graphic here, but it's okay. It's an important point. If you don't ask, you don't learn, you don't get, and you don't learn, that would be horrible. So to help you folks out there on the web ask questions, I'm going to turn it over to my trusted associate, Mr. Joe Lilac, who's going to tell you how you can ask questions if you're online. Joe, take it away, my friend.
Hey, guys. If you want, I'll be in the chat room today taking questions from the viewers. If you don't feel like being chatty in the chat room, you can go to the events page at the top of the screen. You can go to the today's broadcast, and then you could submit your questions down at the bottom of the page. So we could get your questions done two ways. And if you want, you could also call. You can call in on today's
On the hotline,
which is 310-489-9067. So hope to hear from you guys.
All right, perfect. Good job there, Joe. Joe's behind the scene, man. You know, he doesn't usually grab the microphone. Usually he has his megaphone, though. Anyway, in addition to the folks that are watching us online today, we have some folks who've joined us right here in the studio. Old school, that's the way we did it when I started in the biz. You had to show up in person looking in somebody right eyeball to eyeball. So I'm going to introduce our studio audience today. I'm going to start on my right with this gentleman right here. Tell us who you are and what you are dreaming of doing about in the music business. Microphone.
My name is Roger, and I sing and I produce music, and I would like to make a living writing songs and producing music.
All right, excellent. Okay, to your right, my left.
Hi, I'm Liz. I'm a songwriter, performer, manager, business runner. I do everything, but that's my goal, to be a paid songwriter.
A paid songwriter as opposed to a performer. Mm-hmm. So, okay, great. This gentleman to your right.
My name is George Fisher. I'm a singer, songwriter, and producer, and soon to be label owner.
All right, great. Okay, that's always fun. Everybody's going to hate you. You have to stick to being an artist. We'll talk about that later. Okay, to your right.
My name is Casey. I am an assistant to a musician, and I am interested in management.
Okay, brave soul. Okay, and to your right, a friend I've met once before. Tell everybody who you are.
My name is James, and my goal is to be the biggest manager thus far.
I love it. Okay, no equivocation there, folks. That's all good stuff. Now, not content to have five people in the audience here today, we like to trick things up here. My appetite for adventure far exceeds our capacity to deliver. We'll see how we do today. We started this idea of a foreign exchange student to highlight this point that learning can happen anywhere. The classroom's not important, you know, tuition's not important. So we started a foreign exchange student program here. One of our applicants who made the cut, according to Cody Romnes, is joining us today on Skype. His name is?
All right. From Vancouver, BC.
All right, Vancouver. What's your name again? I didn't hear that.
Keegan Jackson.
Keegan Jackson from Canada, actually. I don't know why, but I run into a lot of Canadians around here, Cody, don't we?
Sure.
What are you dreaming about doing, Keegan?
Owning my own business, becoming a successful manager, and helping musicians, artists, and bands better their business.
Okay, wants to be a manager. God, never ending supply. God bless you, by the way. You know, I kid about being a manager all the time. I used to look young. Now I've aged a bit, but you know what? It's a great place to be, and I've enjoyed it. Before we get started, I wanted to tell you just a little bit about our website. I mentioned we don't really have a campus here, but we do have a website. It's renmanmusicandbusiness.com. That's www.renmanmb.com. Consider it our library of sorts, where you have endless supply of advice and counsel and experience and insight from some of the smartest, most talented, most successful people in the music business. Over 500 clips of information, all of it free. So when you're looking around trying to figure out this business, before you send me an email, I'm going to tell you, go to the website, go through our library and pick it out. Do we have the website? Can we show it to him, Code? We can't. Oh, we got Skype on. Okay, but you figure it out. And you know what? I want you to go through that feed. I want you to click on links. I want you to type in things in the search button and do some homework. It's a great place to start. Okay, if you want to keep in touch with us, the best way to do that is the newfangled way of social media. You can reach us on the web at Twitter at RenmanMB, on YouTube at RenmanMB. I'm happy to report we just passed 3,500 subscribers. I want to thank all the people that have been joining, a lot of you lately, which I'm stoked to see. If you want to see some pictures of dogs and behind-the-scenes shots, you can go to at RenmanMB on Instagram. And finally, Facebook.com/RenmanMB on the old Facebook juggernaut. All right, let's get started today. I want to introduce you to today. My guest is one of the top attorneys in the music business. He is a partner and co-chairman of entertainment and media at Manat, which is one of the top entertainment law firms in the business. His clients include some of the top artists in the alternative, country, metal, classic rock, and pop genres. He's worked on both sides of the table as an attorney, primarily as an artist advocate, but he also served for about 4 or 5 years as the head of business affairs at the legendary Capitol Records, that round building we all know and love here in L.A., which provides him with a unique perspective on this whole lawyering in the area that we're going to be talking about today. He also happens to be one of my longest-running friends in the music business, a devout Laker fan, which is being tested today in a big way. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please welcome my friend, Mr. Gary Gilbert. There you go.
Buddy.
All right. Sure.
I noticed that when you ask what anybody want to do, nobody wants to be a lawyer.
That's true. That's true.
Thanks a lot.
Yeah, there you go. Well, at least you have no competition in the air. I want to thank you first, G, for coming out here today.
Sure.
Believe it or not, Gary volunteered for this duty here today. So, anyway, so I want to thank you because you're going to provide some interesting perspective. People ask me all the time about all these key agreements here, and it's important stuff. But before we do that, everybody I've had on our program, or Renman Live and otherwise, the thing that I know about the music business, and you'd probably agree, is that the toughest thing is getting started in the business. Would you folks agree? So I like to tell everybody or show everybody or let my guests tell you how they got started. And so I'm going to ask you today, Mr. Gilbert, you could have done a lot of things in life. You chose to be a music... Music business. How'd you get started?
Well, I was a senior at USC, and... I was a journalism major, and was a senior in college. I had no idea what I wanted to do, and so I went to a job counselor, and I said, "What kind of job is there for somebody who doesn't want to do anything, doesn't know anything, and wants to go on vacation all the time and get the chicks?"
Singer in a band.
I said, "The music business. Be a music lawyer. You don't have to know anything. You have to take this little quiz called a bar exam, and that's it.
That's it.
So that's for me.
That's it.
I just made that up. Okay.
Yeah."
The real reason, the real reason I got in is I was in a big law firm and I had done litigation. I was a trial lawyer and then I was a corporate lawyer and I hated being a trial lawyer and was bored by being a corporate lawyer. And then a guy came in the firm who did music and I loved music and I was a little worried about doing stuff in that area because I was afraid it would ruin me for the music business. And the guy said he wanted some corporate guy to do music related stuff and nobody else wanted to do it. So
really?
I love music, so I did it, and then I've been doing it ever since. It's allowed me to tolerate being a lawyer because what I love about it is the music part of it, not the lawyer part of it. Mm.
Yeah, it's just the thing we talk about a lot is that people out there think that there's, you know, with music business lawyers, right? I tell people all the time, there's a big difference between just being a lawyer and being a music business lawyer. You know, going having a real estate lawyer, talk about the stuff we're going to do today is not a great idea, but... Part of being a big-time entertainment music attorney is the relationships, isn't it? You kid around about it not being a lot about the law, but it's kind of true. It's about the relationships.
I was talking to somebody today on the phone about that, and they were saying, "God, how do you like being a therapist in a certain area?" And I said, "There's nothing new here. I mean, that's what it is. It's a lot of psychology and therapy, but that's the part I like. I like the strategy part of it, of helping to build a career, going from point A to point B and connecting the dots. And it's not just about the contracts. It's like, what's the right move here? What's the right move there? And those are all strategy decisions.
Yeah, and I tell you what, folks, that's an important point because the people that have been successful in this business are experts in an area, but they all have a tendency, not a tendency, a need to see the biggest part of the picture of the business. And we talk about it a lot, that big picture is important. So great stuff there. Let's talk about the four. Now, there's all kinds of agreements that you deal with during the course of your day. But I think the top four agreements we've listed over here that we want to talk about today are band member agreements, management agreements, because everybody, once they get a great lawyer, they need a manager, very common. We want to talk about recording agreements and publishing agreements, and I think we'll talk about some other ones if we have some time there. So let's start at the top. The band member agreement. What are the top four or five points, key points that we need to talk about that these folks need to be aware of, whether you're going to be representing an artist or actually being an artist?
Well, these are the questions. The answers are always different for every group. Every group has different answers to these questions. The first question, obviously, is how do we make decisions? Is it unanimous? Is it majority? Is it one guy? Who makes the decisions? And you'd be surprised how every group has a different answer to that question. Another big area is the changing of members. Adding a guy, gets overrun by a car. If somebody wants to leave, how do you handle that? You want to get somebody out. You want to kick a guy out of the group. Is that a unanimous vote? Is that a majority vote? Is that one guy? How do you do that? And I hate to say it like this, but if somebody dies, are you left being a partner with the girlfriend or the wife, or do you have to buy the guy out and that kind of stuff? Another really important area is ownership of the name of the band. That's the trademark is really important because that has, as the band gets more successful, that has a lot of value to it. And the question there is, who owns the name? And in a band, let's say there's five people in a band, it doesn't have anything to do with who made up the name. It doesn't have anything to do with anything else. You agree on who owns the name, and that's who owns the name. It can be all five guys, it can be one, it can be three, and that's who owns it. But it does. But people get confused by, well, this guy made up the name. That doesn't matter. What matters is, what do you want? Who do you want to own the name? And that's a very important step, because later on, if somebody leaves the band, somebody comes in the band, it becomes a very important question, particularly in a band that where the name has become so important. You know, you hear the name Led Zeppelin, you know that's a band. Before you heard there was a band, you had no idea what the hell that was.
Yeah.
Another area, just like this decision-making thing, is the splits on the income. You know, when money comes in, how do you split that up? Like on publishing, for example, in a band, some people write, some people don't write. So some bands have one guy who writes, and they still split up the money equally with everybody. Just as a matter of, we're one for all for one. Some bands, one guy writes, and it's only him who gets a piece of the publishing. So it really depends on how you want to make it happen. But those are the questions, and the answers are different for every group.
Let's talk about this idea of the band members and participation. We got a question from one of our members here. From Brazil. It says, hello, Steve. I'm at the beginning of a band. We don't have a name yet, but we're writing some songs and we're excited to release an EP some point this year. Right now, it's just me and my best buddy, but in the future, we're going to need musicians to perform with us. I'd like to know how much I should pay the musicians for gigs and band members. I'll answer that one, as little as you can in the beginning. He says, I write most of the songs. This is really the question. I write most of the song. Who makes more money, Mr. Gilbert? He who works more, or should payments be equally distributed between band members? Thanks a lot. Love the show and love your generosity. Well, I love you for saying that. Gary, what do you think? What's the answer for that?
Well, again, the answer to that is it's different for every group. I mean, it depends on, you know, some people believe on who puts the most time in gets made the most. Mm-hmm. Some groups don't believe it. Some groups believe it's one for all for one. And what I do try to tell bands is, you know, they'll bring somebody in, I want this guy to be a shareholder. I said, are you sure you want him to be an equal with you? Because later on, if there's a problem, you know, everybody at the start of a band wants to be really generous. And that's a good thing. The problem is, as time goes on, you may change your mind. So you got to be very careful about who you cut in as an equal member. But again, that question is different for every band. Every band has a different answer.
Yeah, and there's some ones that come to mind. U2 was one of the famous bands that split publishing and all of the income equally for years. That's one model. There's been others over the years where Jagger and Richard were the songwriters, and I presume that excluded Charlie and Bill Wyman and some of the other guys in the band. So those are real decisions, and I think from my perspective, when bands start, it's all one for all and all for one, but as this gentleman pointed out here, when the game starts playing out, you find that not everybody is equal in terms of their effort, their talents, and so forth. And so this is important stuff that goes on here, and not tricky stuff. I want to go back to this point of the decision-making process. You talked about band members dying. You talked about how that whole decision process comes up. One of the great ones that comes to mind for me is The Doors, right?
Yeah.
Key band member, singer, dies. Three band members carry on. Ray Manzarek and
Densmore.
Densmore was the drummer. Robbie Krieger was the guitarist. Krieger and Ray Manzarek continued on as The Doors. Densmore didn't want to have it. The greatest example was that car commercial that where they used the Led Zeppelin song for was it Cadillac?
Yeah.
That was originally offered to The Doors, Break On Through the Other Side. Two band members wanted to do it. Densmore didn't, and you needed to have all three to make the decision.
That
right?
was their agreement. And again, every agreement's different with every group. That was their agreement. That's right.
So those are some of the impact of these things. They're changing bandmembers. I've been through it as a manager God knows how many times, and it's an issue. That whole change of band members. When a band member leaves, right, talk a little bit about what happens for them typically, whether in terms of continuing, you know, financial involvement in the records and stuff that they've worked on.
Well, again, first of all, it depends on if you have an agreement. Let me go back to that for a second. When you should have a band agreement, and that's an important question, too. I'm a lawyer, so I want people to have agreements for everything. That's what I'd like. The problem is when a band starts out, they don't have the money to pay somebody to do it. So what do you do? And generally speaking, they don't have one. So I'm dealing with a situation right now on a very well-known band where somebody just left, and we're working that out. We're talking, you know, there is no rule to it because, you know, I represent the departing member in this situation. I've done both. And so you try to maximize the value of the trademark while that guy was there. What did he write? All that kind of stuff. There's no rule to it. But that's one reason we like to have an agreement, because that makes a rule. Mm-hmm. Then the rule's there.
It's another reason I think why you need to have a music business attorney. because people that are just lawyers that think the music business is easy, people think that all the time. Gary, these guys in the music, but they don't know anything. These are the kind of subtle things that, having been around the block a few times and see these things play out, and trust me, fair to say they can get ugly.
Well, they can get ugly, and here's the. It's not rocket science. It's not really tough. But what it is very experience oriented. So in other words, somebody from the oil and gas business could make millions and come to the music business and lose their shirt, because there's all these rules to the music business. If you don't live in it day by day, you don't know those rules.
Yeah. In golf, we call that local knowledge, and I'm reminded because one of my friends came in here who knows a little bit about golf. Okay, let's take some questions here for folks here. First, we're going to start here, and then, Joe, if you've got some questions in the chat room. Roger, take it away.
I was just curious. You said when a band member leaves, now, do those band members
still get paid on money made from that band if they continue?
The guy who left?
Yes, sir.
Depends on all sorts of circumstances. Did he leave voluntarily? Was he kicked out? What was his contribution during the time? Was there something he did that hurt the band? There's all those factual things that go into those decisions. And every situation is different. I've been involved in a major group where somebody left, and I represent the group, not the person who left. In that situation, my understanding was the person who left didn't want to be a performer anymore. That person sued the group anyway, saying he was forced out. But, I mean, you know, those things happen every day. That person sued the band.
And they can continue to get
If they're contribute, right. If they're okay. It depends. Again, it depends on what was their contribution.
What the contract was before.
And there's other complications. For example, some bands make a record, and some other musicians in the band don't work on the record. They only work on the road.
That's
what do you
true.
Do with that situation? There's all those facts, and it's a factual thing before you get to the answer.
Okay, I appreciate that. Thank you so much.
It highlights something that we've talked about here frequently, is that it's been my experience that people are trying to learn the business want to have an easy answer. They want there to be a checklist. They want to say, if I do this, 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 and this, Ren, can I get something? And the truth of the matter is, it doesn't work that way. That's why I ask everybody, how do you get started? Everybody wants to know how you get started. There's as many different stories of getting started as there are successful people in the music business, you know? So get over that notion, folks, if you're watching out there and you're looking for some nice, easy, tidy, sexy answer. Maybe you should be a scientist or a mathematician, right? But in the music business, it could be the weirdest science and the weirdest math you've ever seen. So don't expect it to add up. Just deal with it.
My understanding is almost everybody I know in the music business stumbled into it. Almost everybody I know.
Yeah. I kind of had a hankering, but I stumbled. I wanted to be a golf pro. And that didn't work out so well. So I decided to become
a manager.
I wanted
to be a basketball player, but I never made it to 6'3".
No, you didn't, Gary, but I'll tell you what, he's a big basketball fan.
But I have some good moves, though.
He's got a very quick first step. That's been confirmed.
Second step, not so much.
Second. Joe, do we have any in the chat room? And then we want to see if our foreign exchange student wants to jump in here.
Yeah, we do. We have one question.
Can we hear Joe on the microphone?
From NJ Taylor. We have NJ Taylor from Canada as an entertainment lawyer. He has been having issues being connected with managers, publicists, and publishing companies in the States. Wants to know if he should switch to a lawyer in the United States.
Probably, because, you know, every location is different. I mean, when I say location, this country, Germany, UK, Canada, they're all different. So just like UK lawyers a lot of times use American lawyers on stuff they have. So I wouldn't say it's a necessary thing, but I think it's a good idea, yeah.
All right, good stuff. All right, how about our friend online, Mr. Keegan? Got a question, or is it all good?
Yeah, absolutely. Regarding who owns the logo and the name, should that be just one person, the lead singer, or should that be split? Like, which works out better?
There's no rule. The fact is, if one person owns it, it better be the leader of the group, because otherwise there's going to be problems. Obviously, the more people own it, the more cumbersome it is. And again, if the group changes people, but the fact is, the group has to decide what are they. And that's a big part of that decision, what they are. You know, who gets what income, who owns the mark? Those are factual questions that are really determined by their, and like Steve just said, the problem with this is, everybody has good intentions when we make those decisions. The problem is, as time goes on, things change. I'll tell you one thing, when money comes in, people get really wacky.
Yeah, I say it all the time. When you start off in a band, it's kind of like, Robin Hood, one for all for one. We're in this together, and that's the way it starts. But over time, it changes, and I'll give you some of my thoughts about the artist-manager relationship and all of that, and I'll give you my thoughts on the singer super vote in that equal partnership. But it's tricky business, and you see it all the time. Roger Waters can't apparently use the Pink Floyd name, but he can use The Wall, and David Gilmour and Nick Mason can be in Pink Floyd. People aren't aware of it, but this is where it happens, and it can get very ugly. So
one thing I would say in a settlement agreement, when somebody leaves a band, normally there's always a clause about what that guy can say about formerly being a member of the band. And that's a negotiation. I did one agreement where I represented the band, and the lead singer hated this guy, and the settlement agreement basically said he couldn't say anything. Normally you can say I'm formerly of that band, but that's a deal point. What can that guy say later on about his affiliation with the band?
Yeah. Hello there, my name is Steve Rennie, and I am the Renman. And I thought we'd take a little break from the Renman U sessions and talk about the course that was spawned by it all. It's called The Insider's Guide to Today's Music Business. If you're looking for a no bullshit, straight to the point look at what it takes to survive and thrive in today's music business, you don't have to look any further. My Insider's Guide is the most comprehensive look at the inner workings of today's music business you're going to find anywhere at any price. Learning about the music business is easy and fun with my Insider's Guide. Let me tell you how it works. The course includes over 150 short 3 to 5 minute video lessons packed with insider knowledge. It's been my experience that in the music business, more often than not, big is good. Each lesson is accompanied by a written transcription for those of you that like to read and follow along while you learn. In addition, each lesson is accompanied by a supplemental video interview highlight from one of my smart, talented guests on Renman Live. So you won't be just learning from me, you'll have 100 mentors to help you as well.
You generally need a label for scale. So if you want to actually be a big artist and actually reach the world and have a lot of and hit all those touch points, which are very difficult to hit, you need an army.
When you finish watching the video and reading the text, you'll take a short quiz to test your understanding of the lesson. Instead of focusing on terminology, the quizzes are based around real-world scenarios you'll likely face in the real music business. Once you've completed the quiz, your score is immediately posted, and I'll give you feedback on all the right and wrong answers to make sure you really understand what's going on. There's a lot to learn in the course, and it's easy to feel a bit overwhelmed by it all, but you'll know you're making progress every time you see that little green check appear by a lesson. It's also easy to keep track of what you've done and how much you've got left to do. The lessons cover all the key areas of the music business you need to know, including how to get your head in the right place. That's the big picture. Making great music, treating your career as a business, building your professional team, managers, marketing and promotion, record labels, music publishing, touring, and getting started. The course comes in two versions. First, the solo version. In the solo version, you'll have full-time access to the course at any time. You can study at your own pace, choose what lessons you want to view and when. You can access the course from your desktop, laptop, tablet, or smartphone. You'll also have exclusive access to our archive of past Renman Live full episode interviews with the top artists and music pros in the business. For those of you that are really serious about your music business career and are looking for some personal attention, I suggest you sign up for the Mentor course. In the mentor version of the course, you'll also get a 1-hour Skype session with me to talk about what you're looking to do in the music business, and I'll help you get a plan to make it happen. You got to do the work, but I'm going to point you in the right direction. I'm so sure that my course is going to help you learn the music business. I'll make you this promise. Take 30 days and go through the lessons and quizzes, and if you don't think my course is going to help you, just send me an email and I'll give you your money back. All right, that's my insider's guide to today's music business. And if you're really serious about doing something huge in this business, I hope you'll check it out. Now, let's get back to the Renman U web series that started it all. See you later. Important stuff, folks, there. So any more questions from the web, or are we ready to move on? Liz is nodding here. You all good?
I have a question.
Okay. Speak in the microphone. There you go.
Does it need to be
renewed, yeah. It takes forever to get it, and once you get it, it's good for a number of years, but it has to be renewed, yeah. And if you don't, if you stop using it, it's a problem. You have to continue to use it. So there's called what's called abandonment. If the group breaks up or you stop using, it's a problem. Trademark's a very technical area. I know enough to be dangerous. There are people who specialize only in trademark law.
Okay. Perfect.
If it's no longer used for quite a while, then
you don't have it anymore.
Yeah. Excellent. Cool. All right. Good stuff. All right, so it's nice having a lawyer around here when you don't have to pay. They're just loaded with questions here, Gary. I got to tell you, man.
I wish my wife thought that.
Yeah, well, you know, she might be calling in here. You never know. The hotline is open. 310-469-9067. Okay, let's move on. Now, we got a couple. So you got one manager, two managers. Who is the third one thinking about? Just two managers. Okay. Let's talk about this management agreement, something I have a little experience with. Everybody's looking for a manager. The good ones are hard to find. More often than not, as we've talked about, they'll likely find you before you find them. But when you do find one, you'll need to sign a management to outline that relationship. So, Gary, what are the top key elements of the management game which we have over here? I'm going to just move this over here for you, Gary, so we can get you over here in the picture there. All right, great. Excuse me for rearranging the furniture, folks. I had a little interior designer came over me. Take it away, G.
So, yeah.
Move over a little so they can see you there in there.
Well,
there you go.
First thing is that obviously the term, how long is it for?
There you go.
And that, again, the thing about the manager agreement, it really depends on the stature of the respective parties. In other words, you could have a very experienced manager and a new artist, or vice versa. You could have an experienced artist who's already got a certain level of success and kind of a new manager. So it depends on who's who. So it could be, I would say, generally speaking, there's no rule of thumb to it. I would say that 2 years is generally probably too short. 3 years is probably more in the ballpark. 5 years is a little long. Sometimes there's 2 years with options to go further if there's certain performance levels, stuff like that. The other area is obviously the commission rate. Basically, it's 15% or 20%. It's not 13, it's not 21, it's not 19. Generally speaking, management, I've seen plenty of both. So people can tell you, well, all managers get 15. That's not true. A lot of managers get 15, a lot get 20. It just depends on the manager. And again, their level of expertise, the stature of the parties, stuff like that. Another area is what is commissionable? Does the manager commission everything the artist does, or is it only music? Is it include acting, all that kind of stuff? And does it include songwriting and all that kind of stuff? Another big question, particularly for the manager, is what happens when the contract ends? When the contract ends, I don't mean if, when, because they all end usually, how long does the artist have to keep paying those commissions to the manager? The first question the artist is going to ask when the deal's over is, how long do I have to keep paying that bozo? That's what they're going to ask. So that's important. And the last thing I would say is the commission itself, 15 or 20, whatever it is, it's how is that computed? Is that of the gross, of the net, some combination, that kind of thing?
All right, let's go back and go through some of these in a little bit more detail. First, that term thing you talked about. I've had a lot of questions over the years from kids that are posting. They want to know, is there a way to kind of audition with a manager? So you try somebody out, you're not quite sure you're feeling, but the truth is you never know till you get there. And it's one of the most important decisions you can make. And if you watched our segment a couple weeks back where I played you the Flo and Eddie describing from the band called The Turtles their manager experience, which sounded like a Keystone Cops segment, but it was all true. It's an important one. Are there situations, Gary, where the initial management agreement has some kind of built-in milestones, you know, things that we got to get a record deal by this point or we have to get a national tour? Is that commonplace?
Well, the answer is yes, but of course managers hate them because managers don't want to audition. Mm-hmm. But again, it comes back to the stature of the parties. But sure, there could be a 6 month look-see. There could be a performance level look-see if I get you a deal by a certain time, that kind of stuff. But again, it's all over the map. So are those possible? The answer is yes. But you know, I mean, managers hate them for obvious reasons.
Okay, we had a question on this whole issue of commission rate, which you kind of already talked about, but I'm going to ask a question anyway because James from San Diego was nice enough and enthusiastic enough to ask the question. He said, he recently started a management company in San Diego. I'm working on putting together an artist management contract. What is a fair manager percentage for a ground level artist? And I want to talk about it because you mentioned the rates are similar, but as artists ascend, that rate can move around a little bit too. Also, what is a fair standard dollar amount when I should start getting paid that percentage? Is there a certain dollar amount that needs to be hit before my percentage kicks in? Keep on rocking, Renman. I will, of course. James, here's your answer.
Well, that I've seen contracts that are where the percentage doesn't kick in unless, or I've also seen them where they don't manage will not commission tours less than a certain dollar amount, like for gigs at $500 or $1,000. I'm not going to commission that at all. Generally speaking, though, managers don't like that either because their attitude is, look, all I get paid on is what comes in. So, at the low levels, they still want their attitude is it's only a percentage anyway, so the money's not coming in. I don't get paid anything.
Yeah.
So, generally speaking, I've seen it, but it's very infrequent that you build in a dollar amount before you get your percentage.
Yeah. Now, as a manager, I'll speak to this. This is why it's fun having Gary here. We always have these conversations in his seats at the Laker game. But as a manager, I'll tell you, because I ask all the time, people will call me and say, I don't know if I can afford a manager. I don't know if I want to pay him too much. And what I tell people is, here's the arithmetic of the management business. No money for band, no money for manager. You're not paying the manager a freaking dime unless they generate some money, okay? So for the people that start figuring out that their manager is getting paid too much, I hope they do the arithmetic of how much they were making when it was zero income before they start getting into that. So for me, I'd be the guy with Gary going, hey, $500, $100, I don't care, man. I need to know that this is going to work, and it's going to be simple. No money for artists, no money for managers. So that's a manager's perspective. You got a question over there, Joe?
Yeah, we got a question.
Okay, Joe from the chat room. Fire away. Microphone, so please, your megaphone.
We got Max Mayers from the chat room. He's got a question about...
Can we hear him, Cody?
I got a mic here.
Oh, you do? Okay, yeah, great. Why don't you just tell me to shut up and be the host, Joe? Okay, thank you.
All right, so we got Max Mayers. He has a question about whether or not if a manager... mixer or producer in studio, if he starts playing a couple cymbals or a couple kick drums, does that manager or person get a writing credit?
That is a really good question. There, sometimes people will call me and say, okay, I was in the studio with this guy and I did this and he did that. What should our split be? I say, don't ask me that. That's not my thing, because you tell me what your split is. Because, for example, a producer, arranger, can produce and or maybe just arrange, and arguably there's a writing contribution in there, but that's a very subjective thing. There's not an answer to that. The people involved in the song have to decide among themselves. I've tried to give people a form saying, when you go in the studio, say, okay, I wrote this percentage. It's never happened once. Why? Because when people get in the studio and they're writing, it's a creative thing and they don't want to think that way.
So yeah, they're vibing. Yeah. I'll tell you this from my perspective as a manager. When the managers start to get involved in the business, whether it's writers and all of that stuff, things get very cloudy very fast. And I'm pretty sure that Irving Azoff has never written a song. I'm pretty sure Paul McGinnis didn't show up in the songwriter credits. He might have gotten an executive producer for one of those videos. But the big time managers, my experience is they follow the same rule I did. No money for band, which is they make the creative decisions and they help try to turn it into money, and that's how it all works out there. Okay, so that's, okay, we have a question here from Casey.
I just wanted to ask your opinion and see if you could advise me on payment for a day-to-day managers. So if an artist gets to a certain level and they need a day-to-day manager,
they need a what manager?
Like a day-to-day manager underneath their contracted manager.
Yep.
How is that payment? I mean, is that something that's paid from the manager? Are they incorporated into the contract?
Normally, a manager is hired and that manager gets a percentage. And normally, that manager will have a day-to-day person that is part of, and a lot of times a manager will be able to say, I am entering into a deal with Steve Rennie. Now, Steve Rennie can delegate to somebody else, but the agreement will usually say, but Steve Rennie will stay primarily responsible for the duties. So if Steve Rennie tries to slough it off to somebody, it's a breach of the contract. So there usually is a day-to-day person, but it's usually taken care of in the percentage.
Yeah, okay. I'll speak to that as well here, is that, you know, for most managers that have a successful act, right, because there has to be money to make money before somebody can go hire somebody else. It's commonplace amongst artists that have, or managers that have successful artists or artists that are generating money. It's not uncommon for them, and in fact, I would say it's probably pretty ritual that they hire a day-to-day person who's a trusted assistant or a trusted associate is a better description of it, who take care a lot of the day-to-day stuff, and that the manager can then focus more on the business development stuff, the relationships with manager or with other managers to get tours, agents, promoters, The key managers spend a lot of time hand-holding the record company and the people that are involved in the marketing. But I've had a great day-to-day person with Incubus for the last 4 years, Joe Lilac over there, who handles so much of that detail stuff. And for the bands, I think, it's important that they have that day-to-day person that can handle travel. And I don't say little stuff, because it's all important, but things that aren't necessarily money-generating, but are things that make the artist feel good about what they're doing. So I pay for that, okay? It's not something we lay off on the band, okay? So let's talk about this idea of what's commissionable, Gary. We, you know, in the traditional sense, it's easy for people to understand. Do a record deal, you get a commission. You do a publishing deal, you get a commission. You do a, you know, you go out and play live dates, you get a commission, you get a merch and all of that. But what's happening more and more in today's world, particularly in the pop world, but I think in other areas as well, is that artists are being presented opportunities today, whether it's a clothing line, whether it's a perfume, whether it's 50 Cent and, you know, made a ton of money on water. Who'd ever bet that, you know, P. Diddy would be selling vodka and clothing? And I'm not talking about in small numbers. I'm talking about in big numbers, Gwen Stefani with her clothing line. How does that play into this whole mix of management commissions?
You mean because they have to pay the company, the sponsors, well, and stuff like that?
Well, that's money that's coming into an artist that wouldn't have been associated in days gone by with, you know, the typical activities of an artist. I write songs, I play shows, performances.
It's going to be part of the management agreement in the first place, but the fact is the artist is going to pay out a certain amount. The artist is going to pay out 15% or 20%. Obviously, you bring in somebody else to add to that picture, to get the sponsorship or whatever, that person... because you might, the manager might hire somebody to help get the sponsorship. That person says, okay, fine, I get 5%. Mm-hmm. And the whole idea is that at the end of the day, the artist is only going to pay out a certain amount in the aggregate to whoever it is. And so that's how you work it out.
Yeah, and I think that's what typically happens if you, and it happens where, you know, somebody might be involved in another area, and you do have other people that might be a specialist, producer, managers. There are people that handle people that are involved in songwriting or composing and all these other kinds of things. In the sponsorship business, there was a company that for years helped put these things together. And the managers, the smart managers, worked it out so that the artist wasn't getting hosed, that everybody would feel good about it. I think Gary would probably agree that if you're dealing with professional people that are seeing the big picture, there's plenty there for everybody on a winning act, and it doesn't pay emotionally or financially to be greedy about it. So that's commissional income. Let's talk about this whole thing when a contract ends. I just had a contract end. Happens all the time, and, you know, it's as inevitable as being living and dying. What are the typical things that a manager, for the managers in here, should be looking at for when a contract ends?
Well, first of all, I represent artists and managers, and representing a manager, that's the most important provision in the management agreement for the manager. Because since the relationship is going to end, you want to know when it ends, what am I going to get paid on? And that's usually when we have what we call a sunset clause. In the old days, managers got paid in perpetuity. They got paid on whatever they worked on, they got paid forever by the artist. That's over. And it doesn't happen that when the manager's out, he gets nothing anymore. That doesn't happen usually anymore. There's some middle ground. There is no rule to it, but I'll just give you an example. A manager did a record deal, and that record's still making money. What you normally have in a sunset clause is that manager keeps making money on that record on a declining basis after the end of the agreement for a certain period of time, and then he's out. So in other words, you might pay him the commission on that record, on one of the records on that deal, if he's a 15% manager, you might pay him 50% for 2 years, 10% for 2 more years, 7% for 2 more years, and then no more. But that's, again, a negotiation. But that's kind of the ballpark of what you do in those things.
Yeah, and it's all based on that notion that if you're a manager and you're working with an artist, there are going to be things that you do, hopefully, big strategic deals that don't play out over a week or a day or a year. They play out over years. And I think it protects both sides. It protects the managers, gives them the incentive to do the right thing. And for the artists, you know, they're going to be benefiting from that money. And it might have some trickiness when they hire a new manager where it gets tricky. That's what I was going to
talk about. That's the trick. When that artist hires a new manager, mm-hmm. I have a situation right now. There's been a lot of manager firings lately throughout our business.
Yes, there has been.
And I represent one act right now and a manager right now in the middle of those things. And what happens is, when you're talking about continuing commissions, it really depends on the situation, and that sunset, there's all these issues of when the new manager comes in, normally what the artist will say, what am I going to pay the new manager? My answer to that is, it depends on the new manager. You say to the new manager, I'll tell you what, you represent this artist. Are you willing to take a reduction because the old guy is going to get, or do you want to still get your full commission? My experience is, the new managers are all over the map. Some new manager will say, I understand you got an issue. You had an old manager. I'll take half a commission. Some managers say, hey, I get my full commission. I don't care what your problem is with the old guy. So really, there is baggage there. It just depends. And isn't that your understanding? It's all over the map.
Yeah, and I think the thing is, and this is something I'll counsel artists out there, because sometimes these things get very emotional, and people on both sides make stupid decisions because they're pissed off or they're upset and so forth. For artists, you need to think about this, because if the next guy, the next person in, next manager in, they're going to need to be incentivized. They're going to need to know that they're going to have some money there, because they're not doing this because they're fans. They might be a fan, but they're doing this because they're professionals. And as we discussed last week, the defining characteristic between career and hobby is what you get paid for your living. So for the artists that don't think it all the way through, and now they're paying the old manager 15%, and now the new manager wants to come in, and he needs to be incentivized. And hopefully for the artists, they're getting a big-time manager, and that's the person that's most likely to say, hey, look, that was yesterday's news. I'm 15%, so that those artists could be actually paying 30%.
And here's the rule.
And for a period of time.
And here's the rule. When an artist wants to fire a manager, the artist has to think about that. And think about, are they willing to pay more? Those are the consequences. You can fire a manager, but there are economic consequences of that decision that you have to deal with, and you can't ignore them.
Yeah, no, and it's true, and it's something really, really to think about, because it's an important one. Okay, so I hate it when the things end like that, but they all do, and it's important to think it all the way through. You know, we talked about this whole notion you mentioned there, Gary. How are commissions, you know, it's easy when it's, if everything was just 15% of the gross, it would be easy. But didn't we just talk about there's nothing easy in the music business, there's nothing quite so simple. Talk about this notion between gross, net, and where it typically applies, and I'll throw in my two cents.
One of the big part of the negotiation management agreement is when you pay that 15 to 20%, how's it computed? I'll give you an example. If you make a record deal, you might get what we call a recording fund. That means you're getting a check, and that check pays for both the cost of the album and goes in your pocket.
We're going to talk about that in a second.
We're going to talk about that in a second. The question then becomes, does the manager commission that whole amount or just the part that you put in your pocket? The answer is, generally speaking, only the part you put in your pocket, but that's the negotiation in the agreement, and it's in there. There are all sorts of deductions. So if I'm representing the artist, I have a list of 100 things I want to deduct from the gross so that the manager commissions more than the net. And in the touring area, particularly, it's interesting in that area, because for new artists, generally speaking, a manager is commissioned on much more of a gross basis. But when the artist becomes more experienced, a big artist, I've had this happen before, where the artist will say, you know, why did I gross $1 million on that tour and you got money and I didn't? Because the production expenses were high, right? So sometimes the artist will say, I'll tell you what, manager, no matter what happens, I'm not going to make less money than you on the commission, on the tour. And sometimes you put that in the agreement.
Yeah, I think that's actually a great point, because that's one that really comes up all the time, right? And it's one of these, if you're going to have a long-standing relationship with an artist and a manager, they have to see the big picture of this, because when the band is just starting off, I'll make the case that it's actually more work for the manager in those early days, right?
It's true.
But when the typical deductions in the touring business that I've been familiar with is you would have your gross, less sound and lights, and support, right? But then video came along. Big videos, lots of videos, lots of lights, right? And I found that artists love big video, big lights, big stuff. And the classic example is Lady Gaga, who we all witnessed recently, and I hope she's not watching so she doesn't start tweeting about me, but had the greatest production in the world, okay? 2 747s full of stuff, 50 trucks, is the biggest extravaganza I've ever seen in my life. So if I were the manager and it was sound, lights, video, I'd sit there and go, hold it, I'm going to do all this work for no money. And by the way, Ms. Artist, you're going to do all this and make no money too. So the way these deals play out gives a little conscience to both sides of the equation, right?
And it's a really tough one, because the artist wants their music to sound a certain way. So whether they really need that percussionist, I remember seeing one of my artists, and if you knew the name, you'd know who it is, but this person had 12, the first time I ever saw this guy, he had 12 people on stage. The first thing I was thinking of was overhead, overhead, overhead. Mm-hmm. And the question is, you know, an artist can say, I need all this to get my sound, by the same token, it costs money.
It is one of the biggest points, and I say this for you managers here today, I say it for you artists. We talked about in our big picture segment, one of these big picture thoughts I talk about that everybody thinks I'm kidding, get the money. Okay, when you're out there doing this and you have a shelf life that's X long, last week we talked about business cycle. It starts and it's gonna end. You start as a manager, it's gonna end as a manager. You need to be thinking about these things because the trade-off of we wanna do a spectacular show, you know what my opinion is a manager and a concert promoter is? If you play their favorite songs and sing them and play them with conviction, that's the steak. Would you pay more money for gravy than you paid for the steak? No way. But I see artists do it over and over and over again. And for you managers that are out there watching today that don't have the cojones to actually bring that up and remind everybody, it's just money, your money, okay? And if you just want to be telling stories when your career is over, I'd rather be living in Beverly Hills, okay?
And by the way, that's something to think about. To do with what hotel room you stay at and what hotel you stay at.
All of these things, you know, the bands that go out on tour and they have to stay in the presidential suite when they're going to be staying for 3 hours or 4 hours, and then they're going to get on a bus at 6 o'clock in the morning, or worse yet, get on their plane to go to the next gig. These are the things that I have watched and presided over that would just blow your mind, but they all have a sad ending to them, which is, where did all the money go? So don't turn around to your manager like, you know, Lady Gaga and say, oh, everybody betrayed me. Take some responsibility for understanding the big picture of what are they coming to see, a spectacle or the songs? I'm humming those Lady Gaga songs. The rest was just gravy. You got a question?
Yeah, I do.
Roger. George, sorry.
Solo artists, so you put a band behind them. What's a good way to approach the musicians that are going to play for the artist according to touring,
one-offs, that's a very good question. Well, part of it, the first thing I would say is I go back to what I said about trying to be careful about who's an equal member. In other words, if you have a guitar player and that guitar is really important to you and you want to, I would tell people all the time, you can compensate somebody fairly without making them a member. Give them a bonus, but don't make them a member. You make them a member, you got problems later on. But in terms of the musician thing, it's a really interesting thing, for managers, because what happens invariably is the manager negotiates the deal for the musicians, and the musicians run to the artist and say, your manager is an ass, he won't, you know, but the manager's just doing his job. But the musicians can get directly to the artist. It happens every time.
Yeah, it does. And I'll tell you from a manager's perspective, my experience is, I've given that speech a few times, which is, you can decide who you want to negotiate with. I know who you're going to be in the bus with, but the managers that have real relationships with the band as opposed to the hired guns, you have a conversation ahead of time. Guys, if this comes back to you, here's what you do. You send them right back to Stevie Boy, you know, and we had some guys in Incubus that were terrific at saying, yeah, it sounds like a great idea. Talk to Steve. And I spent a lot of time over the years going, well, he told me, yes. Did he tell you to talk to me? Yes. Okay, now here's why that's happening. Here's what it is. So you got to be clear about it. It all is about being honest and upfront. And as a manager, you're trying to do the right thing for everybody. You want the musician to feel good about it, but there's a big difference between a hired gun and the person that brought the people into the building. Ronnie Wood from the Rolling Stones, great guitar player. He's not a partner in that band.
Okay? It puts the artist in a very difficult position, too, because the artist wants the people to be happy and loves his guitar player or whatever, but it's a business.
It's a business. It's a music business. You're grinning over there. Yeah, it's good stuff. Okay, so let's talk about real quickly. You talked about this idea of when to sign a management. And I think the idea is as soon as you can't get somebody good. You told me a little story on the when you were called, we talked earlier about this idea between bad manager, good manager. Share that story if you would.
Well, it's really tough to find good. I'm asked to recommend managers every day, and it's really hard. But the bottom line is, I would rather somebody have a manager earlier than later, because a manager, in terms of planning ahead, if you're in earlier, you can have a bigger playing field and you can make bigger plans. But having said that, if you have the wrong manager, I think that's worse than having no manager. Because the wrong manager can lead you in a way that, you know, that you have to, it takes you a while to recover from. And it's tough because there are no qualifications for a manager. You know, you can just be a manager. And so there are obviously some very good ones, some very bad ones. What an artist really needs is somebody with enough clout to do them some good who will return their phone calls, not the B-level manager who isn't that good who will return the phone calls.
Yeah, now you need somebody that can help you along. It's very tricky business, folks, and you never know till you get there. And at the end of the day, you'll have to trust. And you do your homework, you ask the questions of those managers, you ask who they talk to, you get a sense of them. Don't be impressed when the first person that comes up to you says, I want to be your manager. I see this all the time where it's like the sailor that's been out to sea for, you know, 10 months. You know, the first anything he sees is in deep trouble, and it's not because
it's like
it was the right thing to do.
The first guy who asked her.
Yeah, exactly. So anyway, there's some other management points that are in those contracts that we won't cover today. Things like manager's expenses, the manager's duties, you know, manager's taking. I think we talked about taking a piece of publishing.
I was going to say one about the management. One thing I want you to give you guys understand that's really important is that one of the things I do sometimes more than ever, which I really don't like to do, is I get people out of contracts. Mm. I inherit people who entered into a management agreement early on and say, get me out of this. Mm. And that we're trying to prevent that.
Yeah, it's tough sledding, folks. If you find a good manager, it's why you see some of the bands that have lasted the longest time. I think Gary would probably agree. There's a large percentage of managers that have been there for a very long time when you see bands that have lasted 15, 20 years, because it's just not easy. If you get there, it's based on trust and everybody doing what they say they're going to do. Okay, questions? Any more questions from the students? We got a question from Keenan.
If there is a difference, if you're managing just a producer on a commission rate, if it's lower than it would be for an artist or a band?
The answer is no, it's not different, but it's a very different agreement. What most producer managers do, and today it's very difficult to be a producer manager because producers are getting paid a lot less than they used to because records, you know, sales are down. So it's very tough. So. It's the same percentage, but normally there's not a sunset clause to a producer management agreement. Well, normally producer managers, if you can terminate them within a certain period of time, but just about every project that manager worked on, he will get that commission in perpetuity. Normally, that's an exception to the rule I gave you about the sunset clause. Mm. Artist, there's a sunset clause. Producer management agreement, normally there's not a sunset clause.
And their commissionable zone is much tighter, and I think that's the reason for that.
Yeah.
Okay, we have another question from the chat room, Joe.
We do. This one came from Deborah Zook Smith.
Our friend Deborah Zook Smith, vocal coach extraordinaire, big supporter.
She had a question about some international visas. What are some ways that international artists can get visas to come work in the United States?
The answer to that is that's a specialty. The first thing I do is I call an immigration lawyer. Because there's a few specialties of what I do, like trademark. I know enough about trademark to be dangerous, and I do a lot of work in it. Immigration, similar. That's a very specific expertise, and for that answer, you need an immigration lawyer.
And Zook, there's also, you know, a step short of immigration lawyers. There's four or five companies out there that typically deal with touring bands that are having these immigration issues because you have to file for visas ahead of time and so forth. And if you send me a note, I'll send you along a couple references. Joe, we'll send her some info there. Okay, great. Any more questions for here in the audience? We're all good. Okay, let's talk, Gary. You know, we mentioned at the top here that. You know, unlike a lot of lawyers, you've actually worked on both sides of the table. You know, while you spent most of your career working as an artist representative, you did a brief stint on the other side of the table with the enemy.
Not brief enough.
Yes, a lot of people would agree. You worked at the storied Capitol Records. Talk about that, making that jump from artist lawyer to working on the other, going to being on the enemy side, because that's typically when you work on the label or the artist side. I was kiddingly about the enemy, but it's definitely working for the other team there.
It was weird in that building. I kept looking for my corner office, and I could never find it.
Yeah, you know? Yeah.
Kept running around in
circles. That was the first lie they told you, didn't they?
I want a corner office. They couldn't give me one. So, I got a call, and the guy said, have you ever thought of going to the other side? And I said, not really. And they made me an offer basically I couldn't refuse because in those days they were drafting a lot of people into those jobs, and so I ended up doing it. And I did it basically for two reasons. One, I knew I'd get a good education. And number two, I knew it would be a deviation from what I've been doing and be good for me. The problem was that I've been an artist guy all my life, And it was really good. My law firm, I like to hire people with record company experience, publishing company experience, for this reason, because you feel like a double agent. Because now that I've been in a company, I know how they think, I know what's said behind closed doors, all that stuff. It's very helpful. I didn't like it. It had nothing to do with anything else other than the fact that I'm an artist guy, and I never, first day I was there, I felt like a fish out of water. I thought, I'll get over that. I never got over it. I never got over it because it never felt comfortable for me. It felt comfortable for me to represent artists. Didn't feel comfortable for me to be on the company side where, you know, we have the money and you want it. I wanted to give it to you, you know, and my job was to hold it back, so.
Yeah, I'm sure they gave you some editorial along the way. I did a brief stint at a label, and I would share Gary's concerns. It was fun. It was a great experience to see things and see how people think on the inside.
Yeah.
It actually helped me so much as a manager. I'm sure it helped you as a lawyer even more so when you got out of there. So, any questions on Gary's brief stint working on the other side there? All right, good. We'll close that chapter right now, G.
Thank God.
It's a great segue into recording agreements. What are the key points of a recording agreement, Gary? There's a ton of them, but we'll talk about a few because we only have a little bit of time.
Yeah, I mean, you could go, recording agreements are like 50 pages long, single spaced. I mean, it's ridiculous. Obviously, one is term, and generally speaking, you know, as you go further, there are different terms, but for a new artist, it would be generally one album plus, say, four or five options for four or five more albums. That's the way. They always want those options. Most artists don't ever get to that point because the deal ends, they renegotiate, whatever, but that's what they want in the first place. Another thing, obviously, is the money. What are we talking about money? We were talking about what we said earlier, the recording fund, which would include both the recording budget for the album itself and the money you put in your pocket. Sometimes it's dealt with separately. Sometimes the agreement is set out like, this is your budget and this is your money. Sometimes it's all part of a recording fund. That's your money. And one thing I should mention, Steve and I talked about, when you say it's your money, that money is all what we call recoupable. Okay, what does that mean? It's a big word and we use it all the time, recoupable. It means that you're not gonna get royalties until that money is made back by the sales of your record by the record company. You do not owe that money back. It's not like a loan. You don't owe it back. If you leave the company, it's not like somebody's going to come after you to collect the money. The record company has owed that money. The record company will say, that guy left the label and he was unrecouped $800,000. End of story. Doesn't matter. You're on to the next. So that's what. So everything's. And one of the things you fight about in a record deal, as a matter of fact, is what's recoupable and what's not recoupable. Of course, I like the word non-recoupable. They like the word recoupable.
I can see why you were conflicted there in capital, Gary, okay? Yeah. I'm happy to see you're back on the right side of the
That's
equation.
That's right. Royalty rates, I would say it's all over the map. I would say you're talking about generally in the neighborhood of, for new artists, anywhere from 14 to 16%. That's a percentage of the retail, more or less the retail list price, although today they call it the PPD, which I'd like to go into, but it would take me 2 hours.
Mm-hmm. It sounds horrible too, PPD.
Yeah. There is a thing like Steve said. There's a thing called controlled compositions. I don't know how to explain controlled compositions.
I can explain it for you.
You can dumb it down for me.
I will. I am great at dumbing it down. Here's what it is: you write 10 songs on a record, controlled compositions. The publisher gets paid by the record company, right? The statutory rate will make it easy, 10 cents. It's not, it's a little less than that. So you've had 10 songs, 10 bucks, you know, or 10 songs, a buck a record in publishing, right? No, you're wrong, because they want to have a special deal that's 75%. Because they're taking all the risks, so you're not getting the full rate, number one. And if that wasn't bad enough, when everybody went to CDs, Gary, right, there wasn't an artist I met that didn't look at a CD as a closet and all of a sudden any discretion about the number of songs and whether all the songs you had on the record were great went away, so everybody's filling it up with 16, 17 songs. Which the label's thinking, hold it, I'm not gonna, I just got you for 25% off this, now you're gonna make it up on number of songs. So they put a cap on the number of songs, and it's typically what, 12, it was 11 or 12?
You're doing songs. Well if you get 11.
Yeah, okay. So that's controlled compositions, highly controlled compositions.
So I will say one thing about that, and that's very practical. If I have an artist in the studio making a record, I will ask, how many tracks are you putting on the record? If they say, hey, we're putting 13. Problem, yeah, generally. You don't want to affect the creative process, but you say, you know, you really shouldn't put more than 11 tracks on the record.
Yeah. Let's talk about this whole kind of, you know, one of the things, the term we, you know, talk about, it's typically one or two records plus a number of options. Question for you, the options are at whose discretion?
Record company.
Do artists think, and you guys think that you actually had a little say in that?
I don't know.
No, so when I say options, they should call it something else, not options.
Yeah, it's
they
a one-sided option. Yeah, one-sided option.
Yeah, okay.
Yes.
We talked about that old notion of the royalty rates. The royalty rates used to be calculated on CDs and the wholesale price of CDs. The retail price of an album today is less than the old wholesale rate. So the royalty rates have stayed the same, but the number they're doing the multiplication against has gotten smaller.
That's right. And the other thing is, I can say from my time at Capitol, which is, again, really instructive, when I was at Capitol, our computation was different than, like, Warner Brothers. So if I had a band that was a bidding war band, both Capitol and Warner Brothers wanted that band, and the band says, we have a 17% offer from Warner Brothers, and we were offering 17%, they would say to us, I'm going with Warner Brothers, because our computation, dollars and cents, was less money. So instead of changing our computation, we'd say, I'll tell you what, we'll give you 18%, but we keep our computation the same. It's all, you know, the end of the day for the exercise is to figure out what are the dollars and cents. That's really the end of the day. What, you know, you take those percentages and try to figure out what's the dollars and cents. And that's one of the reasons why you need a good business manager and accountant.
Yeah, there's a lot of things you don't think about and why it's easier to write a song than try to figure out how to make money out. I got another one that came up all the time in my brief stint at a record label. I had somebody there who shall remain nameless said, God, Rennie, you're the greatest bad news deliverer we've ever seen at the company. I said, well, that's easy. I've been a manager. All I do is deliver bad news. One of the things I hated to tell people is that record you made that was so great that you loved, that A&R guy that signed you, that loved you so much, sit down, we're not putting your record out. What's that all about, G?
Yeah, I learned about that when I was the record company too. Being in the meeting with the senior VPs, they're talking like this on a chalkboard saying, you know, we got four albums coming out here. I think we're gonna move this one over here. Now, in saying that, they weren't thinking about the fact that manager had set a tour that was centered around when that album was coming out. And I'm sitting there being an artist guy thinking, can they just do that? And then they needed somebody to go to the manager and say, dude, I gotta tell you. The guy says, wait a minute, we got all this TV set up and whatever, and the record company just moving it around like it's chess plate pieces on a chessboard.
Yeah, that would be the better solution. You know, the worse is the one where you tell some artist that your record's not coming out, and then you've gotten this call, Gary, if they're not putting my record out, how come they won't give it back to us?
Yeah, well, I got a couple things to say about that. Number one, they're pretty much never going to give you a record back. I mean, I've made that argument. I've done it. I've been able to get records back on occasion, but generally they don't owe you the record back. There's no
work for hire.
There's no performance guarantee on behalf of the record company. But another one I will tell you that I come up against all the time is a record deal. Usually is for the world, for worldwide rights. So you make a deal with Warner Brothers Records for the world, meaning not just the States, Germany, UK, whatever. The one little problem. You argue, you try to negotiate commitments outside the U.S. for putting the album out and all that kind of stuff. Generally speaking, those commitments are pretty weak. And so I was always arguing, let me get this straight. You have worldwide rights, but you don't have worldwide obligations. And the answer is no, they don't, for the most part.
Yeah. Does everybody understand what that means? That means because what happens is big record company, they might put the record out here in America, and the company in Germany may go, we're not feeling it. Right? We're not feeling it. And again, the manager might have tour dates and all this stuff booked up, and that's not part of the deal. So it's something we didn't list it on here, but territory is one of those things to talk about.
I'll tell you how that works, too, in the real world. The president of the company goes to the guy in France. Mm-hmm. Let me tell you this new Umpiub record, and the guy doesn't like it. He comes back, sorry, the guy didn't like it. And the artist goes, that's it? And that is it.
Yeah.
It doesn't come out in France.
Okay, I got a pop quiz for you folks. You look like a smart bunch here. Anybody guess why the labels will not give you that record back? Why they wouldn't just let you buy it back or something? George.
Because they want to continue to try to maybe license it for film or...
Anybody else want to take a crack at it?
That would be good if that were true, but it's not true.
What do you think, Roger?
I think it's because they own the mechanical rights to that record.
Wrong. No. Okay, who else wants to take a crack? Anybody in the chat room want to take a crack at it?
Case
Here's why, because if somebody else put the record out and it was a hit, they'd look like the dumbest guys on the planet, wouldn't they, G?
They're always afraid.
No, this is bumming you out, I know, but this is the real world here.
I'm sorry.
Liz, I'm not trying to, look at her.
She got a headache.
Liz, are you okay?
let me tell you one more that may give you a bigger headache. No, I had an artist on a record company in Nashville, and big hoopla, every company wanted this artist, and they spent a lot of money on the artist, and it didn't work. and nothing ever happened. And I went to the head of the company, I said, why don't you just let her out? You know why? Because he was afraid that she'd explode someplace else. How about Bruno Mars? He got dropped by a company.
Motown, yeah. Well, we can't say that. Did I say Motown? Scratch that from the record. All right, so some genius over there is trying to explain. No, I didn't cut him. Yeah. It was that guy that we brought in, Gary Gilbert, who talked me out of it. Jeez, you know?
That's right.
Happens. Here's the other great hot button. Okay, good question, George.
But how is it that the
country artist, I can't think of his name, he was able to buy his record back.
Tim McGraw?
Not Tim McGraw, blonde hair, big
Keith
guy.
Keith Urban? No. He's a little guy.
Toby Keith.
Because he probably, when he said he's going to go kick somebody's ass,
every all I can tell you is this. I've been in the middle of those things, and they're all different, and there's all these things going on, you know, give and takes on all sorts, and you never know what the... You'll never know what the real reason is. When those things happen, the agreement you do also has what you call a confidentiality clause in it, and that says you can't tell anybody why this happened. So I've done it before, and where you're threatened litigation, whatever, you don't know why. But there are reasons why it happens.
This is why it's so important, you know, if you get a chance as a manager to ever work inside a label to see how it really operates. And by the way, I make fun of the labels, but I'll say this. It's a very tough place to be. It's staffed by people that really do love music who get put in situations that are difficult. We got a question from Keegan. Keegan from Canada, you're on. Keegan, can you hear us?
With streaming.
What's that? Start again. We missed the first part of that question.
Just how all of this, with all this... information, how it's changing now with streaming music.
In terms of the royalty rates?
Yeah. Is that going to all remain the same? Or
I can tell you right now. I just had a situation with that with an artist. I had a group, and somebody left the group and did a solo record. And the company said, I'll tell you what, we'll do a solo record with this artist, and we'll keep the same deal we had with the group, and we'll just change this the fund for the album, that kind of thing. And so we get the contract, and the contract has a different royalty rate for streaming than we had in the first place. I said, wait a minute, what happened to, it's going to be the exact same? Well, that's our new policy. I said, not on this deal it isn't. But the point is, everybody knows we're going to streaming, and so the record companies, what happens is some guy way up in the ivory tower tells the business affairs guy, go get this. And the business affairs guy doesn't really understand it that well, but tries to go get it. And the fact is, we all know. So it's going to be a bigger fight. It's going to, because they all know it's going to streaming, so they're going to try to pay you less.
Yeah, and truth of the matter is, some of these things just weren't anticipated, right? This is a brand new Wild West out here. Let me give you a new Wild West one. That's something that I still have a difficult time getting my arms around. This notion of the 360 deal, right? There's a lot of people that could say, hey, why should I invite you in on all four pieces of my business when, and some people would say, you screwed up the one that you're supposedly experts in. Talk about 360 deals.
Well, the answer is the record companies are taking the position that their profit margins have dwindled because obviously CD sales are down and so forth. So what they say is, I'll tell you what we'll do. We'll take a piece of your touring income, we'll take a piece of your merchandising income, publishing we argue about, and they will argue they need that for their profit margins. Of course, an artist representative, we say, we don't want to give that away. I will say that most majors are now doing it across the board.
Yeah.
Now, one of the reasons we go to indies sometimes these days is a lot of the indies are not doing that. Mm. And another area that you're pretty much able to negotiate better than others is publishing. They're a little more sensitive to not taking a piece of publishing or taking a lesser piece of publishing, but they still want it. So it's a fight. But generally speaking, 360 deals are here to stay. I said to Steve this the other day, that even though they have a piece of these things, they still not quite sure how to do it. We did a deal with somebody recently where there was a merchandising agreement as part of the record deal because they want a piece of the merchandising. The guy at the record company didn't understand merchandising. So he was negotiating an issue that he didn't understand.
Yeah. It's tricky business out there, folks. And to be fair about it, the labels are making less money than before. They have less people there. It really has gotten tougher. I think the real issue there is that forever, even in the old record business, the winners paid for the losers. And if you were lucky enough to be one of the winners, and I know I made this comment more than a few times and nobody liked it, which is, hey, I didn't sign those losers, man. I got one of the winners. Where did it say that I have to be the welfare agency for all the stiffs you signed out there, right? So it's tricky business out there, and it's being sorted out as we speak. There are a number of other issues. You talked about recoupment. We talked about what guaranteed release and so forth. There are re-recording restrictions. After you get done with your deal, You're still not done with the labels, are you, G?
No, at the end of the deal, there's usually a set time within which you can't re-record that song. So you go to another company, you can't re-record those songs for a period of time. And sometimes what people do to get away from that, if they can do it, is they try to get around that. But the bottom line is, there's all sorts of creative things you can do, but you're not going to get away with it, generally speaking, within that time frame. They're not going to let you re-record that stuff. I mean, sometimes if an artist leaves a label, we will negotiate a modification of that, maybe a shorter time or something, but it's not easy.
Yeah, and anything that's recorded during the term, live stuff that you did, even if you paid for it out of your own pocket, right?
Part of the agreement. Technically, during the term of the agreement, everything the artist records belongs to the record company.
All right, Liz, you ready to hang it up? Have we depressed you enough? Okay, Mike.
What if the record label is no longer? And I own half of the public.
That label still owns, but what we say is no longer. There's usually a successor to that company. So somebody owns that. Whatever those masters are going to be owned by somebody. If the company goes out of business.
How would you find that? Like, say, I am a former recording artist, and I was on Solar Heinz, and they are no longer.
But normally, somebody succeeded to that company.
There's an estate, if you will, even if it's died.
Yeah. Okay. It's somewhere. And
so then there's no more.
Sometimes you have to look for try to find who it is, yeah.
Oh, God, I just love, I wish you folks out there on the web could see what I'm looking at right now. Oh, God, I feel like the freaking hangman here today. All right, well, let's move on to brighter things here. Gary, how does somebody go about finding a great music business lawyer like yourself? I'll say that I know you're too modest, but how
First
do they find
all,
a great
aren't
lawyer?
Any. No, just kidding.
We got one here today, folks.
I don't, that's a tough question. I mean, it's like finding a good manager because the question is, I represent new artists, but I represent new artists on a very selective basis because we're in a personal service business. You got to give attention to somebody. Mm. So if you take on too many new artists and you don't give them attention, you're not doing anybody any good. So it really depends. I think anybody who's any good is busy. I love getting a client from somebody. I'm not with that guy anymore. He's too busy. You think I'm less busy than that guy? I mean, everybody's busy who's any good. So the point is, they've got to believe in you enough. So part of it is playing A&R guy. Part of it is, do I believe in the music?
Yeah. Now, let me ask you this. I know that you're a big-time guy. You're one of the top guys in the firm, and you've been doing this well. So you're in one of those big corner offices, I hope now, right? Is it easier for people that are trying to connect with a big firm rather than trying to get Gary Gilbert? Would they be better off trying to get the new Gary Gilbert that's just come in, maybe a little green, but has access to great people to get his attention?
Yeah, we have a department with younger guys, and sometimes a guy who's out of law school, 5 or 6 years to work with a lot of the newer bands, that's a way to go, yeah.
And so how does an act that's just starting off, that's not making any money today, but has talent, how do they pay
Let me say about Kent contacting first. One thing I didn't say is the best way to find the lawyer or the manager is to have some credibility around you. In other words, what I respond to is a recommendation from somebody I trust. Mm-hmm. I would say that is a credibility issue. So that's one way to do it. Mm-hmm. So what was the next question?
Yeah, no, we were talking about how does it, a new act who doesn't have any money, how do they pay a lawyer? Is it a retainer? Is it how does that work?
We get paid, we have certain hourly rates and all that kind of stuff, but we understand a new act generally doesn't have any money. So what do? So sometimes you take on a percentage, just like a manager does. And sometimes we work on a flat fee basis, which means you don't owe any money. We get a deal, we get paid when the deal is made. But again, we have to be very selective about that because, again, obviously, if we take on too many acts that are percentage and nothing happens, we're spending a lot of time and not doing anybody any good. So you have to be very careful how many acts you take on. But I think most people doing what I do understand the new act doesn't have any money and you don't expect to get paid right off the start.
I think the important things for you people out there watching to understand, because it's not just true for lawyers and managers, there is this kind of qualified access. The buzzword today is curated, right? And the typically that's referred to as music. But everybody's curating to a certain degree because it's so tough that they're taking qualified shots, okay? And the really successful people, the catch-22 is the people you want are the ones that are the busiest, and they're the ones that know just how tough it really is, okay? And it, not to dissuade you, but you gotta ask to get, right? So Gary gave you some great advice.
It's the self-starters, the people that the labels want, or managers or lawyers. It's the people who already understand it's a business and are working hard on it. They're already on the road. They're already doing a lot of social media, whatever it is.
No, it's so important, folks. Okay, now let's finish up with music publishing agreement, right? One of the key agreements that you signed. Key terms there, G?
Well, first of all, we know what that is. That's writing the songs, right? So normally there are two basic types of publishing agreements. One is the songwriter and one is the artist. An artist publishing agreement could be album by album. So it could be one album plus three options for two or three albums like that. For a songwriter, it would be year by year with a delivery commitment usually, with having to write so many songs per period, that kind of thing. Same thing on the record deal in return advances. You'd be paid usually a writer deal would be paid yearly advances, again, recoupable, and with option pickups and so forth, like we talked about the record deal. There are the other thing we always talk about is reversions of the copyright. If you do a co-publishing agreement, one area that's very important to everybody is when do you get your songs back? In a publishing agreement, generally speaking, you can get your songs back. That's a really hard negotiation. Some publishing agreements won't do that at all, but that's an important stuff for an artist. We want it back. The delivery commitment we talked about, and in terms of ballpark of delivery commitment, it could be anywhere from five, depending on the kind of writer, five songs per year, 10, 12 songs per year. And that's the way it can count. If you write half a song, that counts half a song. Doesn't count as a whole song. And the other thing is that the royalty splits are a co-publishing agreement. It's hard. It gets esoteric, but a dollar comes in. Generally speaking, in a co-publishing agreement, the writer's getting 75 cents of the dollar. That's how it works out. Yeah. I can be more detailed about it, but it's more confusing.
Well, we talked about when we had our little session with James here. A dollar comes in, 50-50 split. Right. The artist gets 50%, the publisher gets 50%. When you sell your publishing, you're selling a piece of the 50%. So if it's a half deal, you keep your artist 50, you got your other 25, James is nodding, and that's how it all adds up. So we should probably post some little diagram of that. Let's talk about this notion of reversion of copyrights. It's something that's happened more in the last few years. We talked to one of the folks that pushed the envelope on that, the most, Richard Griffiths, who was a publisher, then the head of Epic Records, a good friend of mine, and now the manager of One Direction. Why is that reversion of copyright so important, G?
Because ownership of that's your annuity. I mean, I think there's no more important thing for an artist than any artist that can write has a leg up. Because if you are a performer and a recording artist, that's great. But again, then you realize that pretty much everything you make depends on your effort. Mm-hmm. You write a song, that song can make you money for years. Eight people cover the song, and you getting a song and owning it, you can do whatever you want with it. There's all sorts of licensing for movies, licensing for commercials. You own the song, you can make it. I have one client right now who's multi-platinum. This artist has never made a publishing deal. We administer her publishing on an hourly basis. She wrote 100% of one song one year, one of the most performed songs in the ASCAP catalog that year. She made a fortune and wasn't paying anybody anything. So. Owning your public, I don't know if this is appropriate to say, but I'll say my opinion. Publishing agreements, my rule is don't make one. Then there's like a zillion exclusions to that, exceptions to that rule. One of them is you need the money. Another one is that company can set up collaboration with other writers. Another one is they're going to get your songs and movies. Problem with the publishing deal is publishers, with good intentions, a lot of times make promises. I'm going to get your songs, I'm going to do this and that, and the other thing, and they have good intentions, and it doesn't happen. So yeah.
We're going to talk about all that and more in publishing. That whole, the reversion of the copyrights, that's the house you're building. And I'll tell you, we didn't talk about all the issues, all the items that deny you royalties in a record deal, radio promotion, you pay for your videos, you pay for your touring, you pay for the cost of recording. In the publishing agreement, there are very few of those exclusions in there. It's typically the money they advanced you, maybe your manager got the record company to give you $50,000 so you could hire a promotion person because the record label really wasn't paying attention. And rather than getting all screwed up about it, you just said, hey, I'm going to make this happen. And if I get the record company's attention, then they'll spend the money. So that's one of the key reasons why your copyrights are so much more valuable, those royalties and that money, than the record because it's unencumbered by this mortgage of promoting and paying. It's the equivalent of paying off your house
Absolutely.
To the bank, and the bank goes, no, we still own it, but thanks.
And
right?
If other people are covering your song, I mean, it just keeps going and going and going.
Yeah. Now, we mentioned briefly, touched on admin deals.
Yes.
I want to talk about it. Again, folks, we could go on for hours about music publishing. We'll go on for at least an hour and a half here in a few weeks. Admin deals. People hear the word. I wanted to do an admin deal, but they have no freaking idea what that means. What is an admin deal?
Okay, co-publishing agreement is the company co-owns your copyright, and then you'd worry about a reversion. Admin deal, you own your copyright. The company does not own. Admin deal, they pay you a percentage, but they administer. They do all the forms.
Collect the money.
They collect the money, but you still own your copyright. What's the difference? Well, the difference is you're going to get a lot less money that way. You're going to get the most money doing what we call a worldwide co-publishing because you're giving away the most rights. Admin, you're not giving away ownership, so you're going to make less money, and all they're doing for a percentage, say 90-10 for 10%, they're collecting your money and so forth, but you haven't given up ownership.
Yeah, and they may not spend as much time going out and getting you licensing opportunities, but they may, in fact, still do that. So that's really kind of for artists that really have something going on where they really need to rent the infrastructure of a publishing company. Fair comment? Okay, George.
So my question is...
For an admin deal, you're basically soliciting your music. If you did an admin deal with a company, they're just handling the paperwork.
Basically, yes. I mean, we try to get we talk. Some companies are more do some marketing, and it's becoming more prevalent with some. I won't mention the companies. There are some companies who are better at it and thinking more about it. The pure definition of admin is they're not out there exploiting. They're collecting. So
okay.
Yeah. Basically, you're not getting help.
Okay.
But that's a generalization.
Gotcha.
All right, thank you. All right, good stuff
there. We got any questions from the web there, Joe?
We do. Kind of like in wrapping up, were wondering if there's anywhere we could download boilerplate contracts, whether it's label agreements, management agreements.
I'll answer that. Oh, go ahead, Gary,
I mean, my answer to that is no.
But my answer is yes, because I knew somebody would ask that question, and I see it all the time.
And I knew we'd have a different answer.
Well, no, the answer is simple. You can find out anything on the web, okay? Now, but as Gary's told you, what you download from the web will just be a snapshot, but it will lack all the nuance and all the detail that might be important to you. That's why today we're kind of outlining the big picture.
Well, I want to respond to that. What I always get is, I just want a routine standard contract. There is no such thing. You know, we like to think there is, but there isn't. Every contract has nuances to it for whatever reason, the different factual pattern, different rest after the parties. To say, and people are always saying that, it's just boilerplate. You know what, you can do it that way, but you know, you're going to be sorry, possibly.
Yeah, I don't think you should be downloading any of these from LegalZoom.com with all due respect to Robert Shapiro.
Or any book you read.
Yeah, exactly. So there you have. Now,
mention any.
Yeah, but no names here.
No.
So there are all kinds of other agreements that come into play here. We didn't talk about the production deal as opposed to the record deal today. That's a long conversation. Agency contracts, music licensing contracts, touring agreements, and so forth. But we did have a merchandising agreement. It's another big one if you're a touring band. None of them are quite as intricate as the ones we've described here. They all kind of follow a similar pattern, terms, advances, and so forth. But there was one, we had a question on endorsement deals from one of our members here that I wanted to ask before we got it. The question was from Eric Ramos regarding endorsement deals. He says, hey, Steve, can you talk a little bit about product endorsements / sponsorship agreements? I'm in a situation where I have an instrument maker wanting me to use their instruments exclusively, and I'm not sure how much I should ask for or how long that agreement should last. G, any thoughts?
Well, you know, it's a pretty general question. I would say this, that the word I'm really fixating on that question is to use our instruments exclusively. One of the biggest areas about how you quantify those deals is the area of exclusivity. In other words, are you exclusive? What did he say? He didn't say what kind of instrument it was. Is it just a saxophone? Is it all instruments? That affects the price. Exclusivity is probably one of the most important aspects of those deals. Generally speaking, those deals are going to be for a certain period, a certain campaign, with options. to say how much it would be is really impossible, depending on what we're talking about. But it's generally going to be a certain campaign, a certain period with options and stuff like that. And again, what the breadth of the exclusivity is a big part of that.
Yeah, and I'll say something as a manager, when you get paid to endorse a product, particularly if it's in a kind of creative skill, whether it's playing guitar or drums, or golfers go through this all the time, where they sign a big deal, and all of a sudden now they're playing clubs or guitars that they really didn't like. And I've been through this in the band, where they had a deal, and then they got tired of using the guitar, and all of a sudden another one starts showing up in the set, and all of a sudden you've got all kinds of other issues happening. And those are the kind of things when he's talking about exclusivity, when somebody's paying you a lot of money, they're putting their money that you've sorted all that stuff out, and they're going to hold you to it.
So you got to be very careful about that, because if you plan to do another deal in the future, and you've had too broad an exclusivity with the other deal, it could bar you from doing other similar deals.
Yeah. But the point of all this is, folks, it's easy to look right here, okay? And it might feel good right there. The real world's out here, okay? And it's why I tell you all the time, if you're looking to do something big in this business, okay, you need some help, because there's all kinds of things that come into play. And understanding the whole of the picture is important. And that's why you have guys like Gary Gilbert to help you with the legal. I'm a manager. I have a general sense about it. But if I have a real question, I'm calling up Gary Gilbert, who will focus in on things that maybe I'm missing there.
And so, I'll probably take his call, too.
He has been for years, and I thank him for that. So anyway, any more conclusion or any more questions before we conclude today? Joe, we're all good? Our friend... our friend Keegan out there on the internet, still there. Keegan, I want to thank you. All right, let's wrap it up today. First off, I want to recap a little bit. For the last few weeks, we've been talking about all these things that I hope will give you a sense of the big picture of how this business works. We talked about the big picture, how to get your head in the right place to do something great, and all the things that go with it. If you missed that thing, I encourage you to go on our website. Click on that thing that says Big Picture, that link, and you'll see all these thoughts that have guided me over the last few years. We talked about building a professional team, and your lawyer is one of the key parts of that team. I told you, your lawyer and your manager are probably the two most key people, and I think you get a little sense of it why today. So hopefully you've started to put together your team. You understand that if you're going to be in the business, Liz is nodding now, it's not just about the music. That would be so great. That would just... Oh, it sounds so romantic, but there's a reason they call it the music business. The business gets in the way of the music, but it's real. So you got to treat your business, your career as a business, to really be successful in this thing. And we talked today about organizing your business. These are contracts and things that you're going to live with for a very, very long time. And so I hope by now that you folks here and the folks that are out there watching, particularly if you've been watching over the last 5 weeks, are starting to make this transition in attitude and action from being a dreamer, which is easy, to being a doer, which is a little bit tougher. Remember, the dreamers, easy. The doers are the ones that are moving the world out there. So first off, today I want to thank all the folks online for being a part of it. I want to thank you folks in the audience here today. I want to thank Keegan from Canada for joining us as our foreign exchange student on scholarships, Keegan, huh? We're giving it away here. But most importantly, I want to thank my friend, Mr. Gary Gilbert, for joining us here today. And give him a little round of applause. Okay. This way, well, the only time you won't be getting a bill on this one. So anyway, next week, we're going to be taking a week off. We're going to be heading to Nashville, Tennessee, for the Polestar Live Conference. I'm going to be doing our first RenMan Live of the year with my friend, Mr. Paul Tolette, the legendary founder of Coachella. Started as a punk promoter. Now he presides over the greatest festival on earth, according to a lot of people, and I would agree. So our next session of RenMan U is going to be on February 26th. We're going to be talking about managers, what to look for, the qualities, the things that go on, the artist-manager relationship, a whole bunch of them. I could do 2 weeks on it, but we'll keep it to an hour and a half or so. So that's it for today, folks. I want you to keep dreaming. I want you to keep doing. I want you to get that fuck the gatekeeper attitude and tell the world, I'm doing this, man. My name's Steve Rennie. We'll see you in a couple weeks. Bye. Great.